Simon & Schuster Audio presents Cape, The League of Secret Heroes, Book 1, by Kate Hannigan. Read by Jesse Vilinsky with Jonathan Davis.
Chapter 1. Morning in Philadelphia. Josie O'Malley is sweeping the sidewalk in front of Gerda's Diner. A new penny gleams up at her and she tucks it into the pocket of her dungarees. A few more passes of her broom, swish, swish. And then her brothers, Vinny and Baby Lou, roll up on their shiny new bicycles. She waves at them as they enter the diner, bell ringing. Time for a break. Josie reaches into her back pocket for a treasured possession. The last comic book featuring Zenobia, the most amazing woman in the universe. Zenobia herself stares proudly out from the cover, hands on hips, hair rippling in the wind. Eagerly, Josie flips through the familiar pages, following the superhero's thrilling adventures.
"Oh, Zenobia," she cries out. "Where are you? Why aren't you protecting Philadelphia anymore?"
Unnoticed, a mysterious woman approaches Josie from behind. Ding, ding. The diner door opens, and Vinny and Baby Lou return to the sidewalk, both munching donuts.
"Sit, Astra," orders the woman. The boys spot the dog and race over to greet him. They kneel down to pet him and slip him bites of donut.
Baby Lou lisps through his missing front teeth.
"Such a cute puppy. What's its name?"
Vinny scratches the dog's ears.
"You heard the lady, Baby Lou. The dog's name is Astra."
Vinny scratches Astra's ears and Astra wags his tail, staring intelligently up into Vinny's face.
"He's a fox terrier, I bet, judging from his ear shape and his wiry coat."
Josie smiles and shakes her head, thinking,
"Vinny, always with the facts."
Meanwhile, the mysterious woman watches the girl. The diner door opens again, ding, ding, and Gerda Gutler steps out, handing two sandwiches wrapped in wax paper to the boys.
"Schätzchen, take these for your lunches. They're extra."
Vinny and Baby Lou race over to Gerda and take the sandwiches, tucking them into their book bags.
"Thank you, Gerda,"
Vinny says as the older woman moves back to the diner door.
"Gerda ate the best,"
says Baby Lou. Gerda waves at Josie and then, ding, ding, she goes back into the diner. Josie and Vinny help Baby Lou buckle his book bag, sandwich tucked safely inside. The mysterious woman is now seated at a bench outside the diner, Astra at her feet. She holds a newspaper in her hands, but it's clear that she is focused on the three children. The boys return their attention to the dog, scratching his ears and slipping him a few final donut crumbs.
"Why is Gerda so good to Vinny and me?"
Vinny shrugs.
"She's got a soft spot for cute little kids, I guess."
Josie laughs.
"Cute kids? Then I have no idea what she sees in you two."
She ruffles their hair fondly.
"Gerda's just somebody who likes doing good."
Carefully, Josie tucks her comic book back into her pocket and begins sweeping again. Swish, swish.
"Like a superhero?"
Baby Lou asks.
"Superheroes haven't been seen around here for years, Lou."
Josie gazes up at the birds flying overhead. The mysterious woman and Astra both lean in a bit to hear what she says.
"But I believe they're still out there. We just have to look for them."
The mysterious lady holds her newspaper, watching the girl from the bench while Astra paces. Josie gestures at the two bright red bikes behind the boys.
"Shake a leg, you two, before the school bell rings."
Vinny frowns.
"How come you're not coming with us, Josie?" "You've got a couple more days of school left, too,"
Baby Lou says. Josie leans on her broom, looking exasperated.
"I told you. The puzzler tryouts are this morning."
Unnoticed by Josie and the boys, both Astra and the lady perk up their ears. Vinny tugs nervously at the cowlick just above his forehead.
"But what if those kids come around again?" Yeah, the Meanith. What if they do more than take our lunches? What'll happen to me and Vinny without you?
The boy's eyes are enormous, staring straight at Josie. A memory flashes. Vinny and Baby Lou being harassed by a handful of seventh-grade boys who push them over and spill their lunches. Josie stares back at her brothers, feeling guilty. She pulls them close.
Won't you feel proud knowing your big sister is a puzzler? Doing her part to beat the Nazis?
Baby Lou wraps his arms around Josie's waist.
You'll do great, Josie. You're the smartest person I know.
Suddenly, all at once, a crow perches on the diner sign, its rough caw ringing out. Inside the diner, Gerda stops suddenly, the plate in her hand crashing to the ground. Just beyond Josie and her brothers, a car pulls to the curb with a screech of brakes, taillights glaring. And a mocking voice rings out.
Ha ha! Josie, you're so smart!
Josie whirls and comes face to face with Toby Hunter, flanked by four beefy bullies. The mysterious woman stands up, and Astra springs to his feet, growling low in his throat.
Toby Hunter, Josie says, and his pack of marauding meatheads.
Astra senses the danger and begins to bark and lunge against his leash. Josie's brothers cluster behind her. Toby smirks at them.
Since when do they let babies go to school?
Vinny winces and Baby Lou shrinks away in fear while the bullies laugh.
What a sweetie pie.
Josie squeezes the broom handle.
Cut it out, Toby.
She stares at him, thinking,
if only I could shoot heat beams from my eyes like Zenobia.
In her imagination, she does just that, straight at Toby and his crew, and then rises gracefully into the air, setting the bully's shoes on fire as they run. Toby takes a step toward Josie, tossing a rock in his hand.
I can't believe you work at this greasy dump, Josie O'Malley. Since it's run by some German lady who could be Hitler's mother for all we know.
Suddenly, he whips the rock straight at Astra, who yelps and barks furiously at Toby. The woman restrains him, glaring with disgust at the bully. Josie, full of cold fury, says,
Leave us alone, Toby. You're scaring them.
Toby stares back at her.
I'll do whatever I want. Who's to stop me?
You?
The bullies laugh. Astra snarls at them while the woman focuses her gaze on Josie, observing her closely. Toby moves closer to Josie and lowers his voice.
Just one word to my dad, and I'll have your family thrown out.
Behind her, Josie's brothers are panicking.
He'll do it, Josie, cries Vinny. And then where will we live?
Baby Lou is close to tears. Toby shoots a cruel smile at the O'Malleys.
I'm really looking forward to this afternoon, so we can take our new bikes out for a spin.
He winks at his crew, a signal for action. Before anyone else can move, Toby and another bully grab the bright red bikes, swing them around, and jump onto the seats. The bicycles are too small for them, but they pedal away, laughing.
Hey! Those are my brother's bikes! Josie shouts. Stop!
Toby waves, calling out behind him,
Summer's going to be even better now!
The other bullies take off running after the bikes, hooting and laughing. Baby Lou and Viddy stand on the sidewalk, stunned, and the mysterious woman and Astra glare angrily at the older boys. Josie can barely contain her rage.
One of these days, she shouts, somebody's going to stop bullies like him!
Chapter 2. When the world needs a hero, sometimes you have to become one. That was my mom's thinking. And it seemed simple enough that even knuckleheads like my brothers, Vinny and Baby Lou, could understand. Because Mom did that kind of thing all the time. Like when she made corned beef sandwiches for the family next door when she saw they couldn't pay for groceries, or gave away one of her best dresses to the neighbor whose husband died fighting the Nazis. So the lady would have something decent to wear to his funeral. For my little family, the whole world was basically our third floor apartment. The one above Mr. Hunter's barbershop on Captain Flexer Street in West Philadelphia, between the cleaners and the weeping willow tree. And as Mam liked to say, I was the hero of it. That's because my taking a job at Gerda's Diner down the block helped pay the rent each month, which kept us from getting kicked out onto the street, which made my little brother Vinny stop tugging on that clump of hair above his forehead and worrying all the time, which made my mom able to breathe. But let's be honest here. Clearing the diner's tables of lipstick-smudged coffee cups and dirty plates stuck with scrambled eggs, that didn't feel too heroic to me. It wasn't anything like the superheroes from years past, the ones who soared over rooftops and battled villains to save our city, using super strength to stop a speeding train from crashing off a bridge, protecting a bunch of innocent people from harm. Now, those were things heroes did, and people loved them so much for it. They named schools and parks and streets after them. Nobody's naming anything after me. Lately, I've started wondering where all the superheroes have gone, because with the war on, we sure could use a few of them flying around. All billowy capes and mysterious masks over their eyes and shiny boots. The papers and radio reports haven't had much news about superheroes. Not since the war's fighting turned really bad. Some people even stopped believing in them. Superheroes were becoming just bedtime stories parents told their kids, like tales of King Arthur, or leprechauns, or the Tooth Fairy. Others started thinking they were just made-up characters in comic books, not real people trying to do good. I couldn't bear the thought. I told myself all the superheroes were off in the Pacific Ocean fighting the Japanese alongside our troops there, and over in Europe, battling back against Germany's Nazis. But to be perfectly honest, part of me was starting to worry they'd hung up their capes and decided to wait for better times. This was the argument Emmett and I were having last night at my kitchen table over plates of Spam hash. We were supposed to be doing homework, but we kept getting distracted. "Face it, Josie," he was saying. "The caped heroes of your beloved comic books are history. Done, finished, behind us. If you keep going on about them, people are going to think you're crazy." "I'm not crazy, Emmett Shea, and you know it." My voice cut through the usual noise in our apartment, over the radio, my brother's Parcheesi game, my cousin's sewing machine, and my mother's tea kettle. "Superheroes are still out there saving people's lives and rescuing dogs and stopping evildoers. They're just quiet for some reason. It's probably the war. Or the heat this summer." Emmett gave me a doubtful look. He didn't even need to say what he was thinking. That's because we both knew that superheroes had been quiet for longer than just the past couple of weeks, when the weather had started heating up. More like the past couple of years. When I really thought about it, superheroes hadn't been spotted in Philadelphia since I was in fourth or fifth grade. "Hurry up and guess, Emmett," I groused, pointing at his pencil. I wasn't annoyed with the time Emmett was taking to solve my puzzle. It was his attitude about superheroes that bothered me. "You've stared at those clues long enough." "Don't rush me, Josie," he said, unfazed by my crankiness. Nothing could ruffle Emmett's feathers, especially when he was puzzling. "And don't be salty with me over superheroes quitting. Hansima, Hopscotch, Nova the Sun Chaser, even that favorite pair of yours. Those sisters, Zenobia and Palomino. Hantima, Hopscotch, Nova the Sun Chaser, even that favorite pair of yours. Those sisters, Zenobia and the Palomino. They must figure there's a whole bunch of puzzle solvers and other smarties like you and me coming to take their jobs. So they quit." He gave me a smirk, then stared harder at the clues I'd laid out for him. 175, 21, 5 to 6, 7, 5, 8, 34, 12, 1, 306, 21, 5. "I don't think it's an alphabet cipher, since some of these numbers are higher than 26, Emmett mumbled, thinking out loud. "So, maybe a book cipher?" I dropped my pencil onto the paper and groaned. He was almost too good at this. I'd have to read up on harder puzzles so I could really stump him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.